I'd like to introduce a world-renowned speaker, a community branding expert, and a friend of ours, Mr. Roger Brooks.
How is everyone? Good?
Awesome.
Ready for some fun? Thanks so much for coming out. I got to tell you that when I was here a few months ago and we did the assessment, I think it was over at the Days or over at the whatever the center is over there, it was like standing room only. And I got to tell you, we've worked in 1,000 cities in 45 states, every Canadian province, Western Europe, and per capita, you have the biggest and best turnouts ever. So thank you so much. So it tells us that you care, and I know that it's not really convenient to come out on a Friday morning, but for you that work, this means you get the rest of the day off, doesn't it? Yeah. So we're going to get right into it because it's going to be some real fun for the next hour. And by the way, it was really great to come back this time of year and see the beautiful golf course when it's not covered in snow. And so that was great. But what we're going to do is talk really quickly about this whole branding thing and what it means and why you are doing this. And the reason you're doing this, there are five reasons why this whole thing is being done. And number one is to put Rochelle on the map as a desirable place to live, to visit, and to raise a family. Desirable. Because one of the challenges you have is people say, well, I live here because I have to. We want people to say, I live here because I want to and I love it. As a matter of fact, we need to put you on the map because niche.com put the 2015 best towns to raise a family in Illinois on their website, and you're not on that list. You need to be and you should be. So one of the big reasons is to get you on this list, because I'm sure right now you're scanning the list and say, we're better than they are. It's not the issue, you're not on the map. So that's number one. We have to get you on the map as an incredibly desirable place to live and raise a family. That is one of our foremost goals of this whole effort. Then number two, to differentiate you from everybody else. You know, next to California and Texas, you have more communities than any other state. 1,299. So what sets you apart from the other 1,298? And by the way, out of the 1,298, about 1,250 of them are fairly rural like you are. And so, you know, that is the other thing. How do you differentiate yourself? Because you know what? We can find every single city and town in Illinois at our fingertips in a fraction of a second via the web. So why should somebody pick you? The third reason why you're doing this is to slow the leakage of locally earned money. You know what? You have more leakage than almost any place we have ever worked. Which means you earn your money here, but you're spending it somewhere else. DeKalb, Rockford, Aurora, Chicago, you name it. And that is huge. And by the way, if the city was a business and you leaked out more money than you brought in, guess what? You don't stay in business. And so another thing is, you know what? You've had more than $1 billion worth of industrial development take place here over the last 10 or so years. $1 billion. But you know how, that's great economic development. But you know what? How does that benefit you when you're creating most of those jobs for people that live in Rockford, in Dixon, in Sycamore, in DeKalb, in other places? See what I mean? And so we gotta stop that. I mean, we did a survey, and I'm going to tell you about that, or a questionnaire for you. And you know what? People said, where do you go to hang out? Where do you go spend your time? And almost all of it was in these other cities. That's not a good thing. And then number four, to make downtown Rochelle a vibrant, active gathering place and a showcase, not just for this county or the neighboring counties, but for the entire Midwest. And you have the bones to do it. You can do this. Because we want you to have a downtown you're proud of and not one that say, oh no, we don't want to go downtown. And that is important. And then number five, we want to improve the image of Rochelle so that when you tell people, that don't live in the area, I'm from Rochelle, Illinois, right now they go, oh, I'm so sorry. We got to change that. And not everybody says that, by the way. But we wanted them to say, you live in Rochelle, I heard about you. That is so cool. That's what we're talking about. That is the five reasons we're doing this. And by the way, when it comes to branding, there's two kinds of brands. There's the feel-good brand that would say, Rochelle, it's a great place to live, work, and play. Which, by the way, that's what all 1,299 communities in the state think. Then there's the economic development brand, the one that brings in more tax base. That is what this is about. This is not feel good. This is physical tax base. Because if we can get more people to live here, wouldn't it be cool if we could get the people that already work here to say, let's head downtown after work, rather than head over to DeKalb or somewhere else? Wouldn't that be cool? And so this is economic development. And you know, I hate to say it, this is about tax base. Because you know what? If we can increase the tax base, local spending here, more people wanting to live here, wouldn't it be nice if you actually saw a new home started to sprout up in Rochelle? That's tax base. And what's cool about that, that provides more money to the city so that they can do recreational facilities and get the golf course going and work, get more money for police, fire, your other things that are in the city that all provide services for you. And so that is the whole goal of this whole branding thing. And so that's what this is about. And so the one thing I want to talk about for just a minute is the 10 things you need to know about branding. And the first one is that it is the art of differentiation, what sets you apart. Apple did a good job setting themselves apart from Microsoft. See what I mean? It's what does it do to set you apart? That's branding. And number two, brand is a perception. Logos and slogans aren't brands. Let me tell you about that in a second. A brand is a perception. So when you tell people, I'm from Rochelle, Illinois, if they go, where's that? Then they don't have a perception of you. If they say, I'm so sorry, then they're saying they have a negative perception of you. If they go, Rochelle, oh, you guys, that's so cool out there. I know you, you're the hub city. Then that's a positive one. And so it is a perception. It's what people think of you. And by the way, how that is created is number one visual cues. If we're on 3988, when we're driving through, whatever we see, people tend to judge the book by the cover, whether it's fair or not. You know, it's people and attitudes. When they pull off the freeway and they go to Dairy Queen or Walmart or those ones that are closer to the freeways, what are the people like? They judge you like that. And then it's word of mouth, what they read in papers. Or what they hear, what they see in social media. And by the way, social media, publicity, word of mouth, it's all together now. That is how perceptions raise or create a brand. And then logos and slogans are not brands. You're going to see logos and slogans today, particularly logos. And you know what? They're not a brand. They only make up 2% of a brand, but they get everybody's attention. You know, we've been working with our brand development team every single day this week, and even yesterday, we started to get into a little debate about the logo. So even among us, we had to say, hold it, wait. Because, you know, at the end of the day, would you buy Reebok over Nike because you think the Nike swoosh is a dumb logo? Of course not. You base it on the product. I mean, would you say, when you go to buy a car, would you say, I'm only going to buy a Chevy because I like their logo better than all the other car logos? No. You're going to base it on the product. You know, and by the way, do you say, you know what, I drink Pepsi over Coke because I like blue better than red. Have you ever said, you know what, I want to head down to Mount Vernon, Illinois because they have a really cool logo? Or have you ever said, you know, I really don't want to head over to Ottawa because I think their logo sucks. By the way, we did both those logos. And they're good. But the point is, yeah. You know. But you know, the point is, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. You know, nobody's going to say, well, you know, you have that hub up on the water towers. I'm not going to move there, or I'm going to move there because it doesn't matter. So I just want to get that out of the way. That's not what brands are. Those are brand marks. Okay, and then number four, you never use focus groups. We worked for the brand development team. They were not a focus group. Matter of fact, when we talked about logos and things, everybody went down a piece of paper and wrote down the one they liked. Because if we tried to make everybody happy, we'd have a really generic logo that would show fields for agriculture. Maybe show a smokestack or two because you do have industry here. And then maybe show a semi-truck because you are a good truck stop. And then we're going to put some historic buildings in there and you end up with just a picture that makes it go like, I don't want to live there. And so they were not a focus group. They were our steering committee. And then a brand evokes emotion. We want people to go, Rochelle, oh my gosh. That is really cool. What you're doing there is really awesome. That evokes emotion. That's what brands do. And then they are built on product, not marketing. So you're going to say, I'm going to spend the most amount of this morning talking about the product that's going to make Rochelle the coolest place in the Midwest. And then number seven, you never roll out a brand. So you're going to see marketing that you can't use, because if we say we have a plan to make downtown the most amazing downtown in the Midwest, and then you start telling people next week, they're going to go downtown and they're going to go, really? I mean, you know what I mean? So you cannot tell people what you are until you can deliver on the promise it represents. Now, you can certainly tell people, guess what this is going to look like in 3 years from now. You can start to build that momentum and maybe people will invest or be a part of it. And then number eight, you cannot do branding by public consent. We did talk to you. We did ask you. And I'm going to talk about that process. But at the end of the day, the brand is built on feasibility. What could we do for the least amount of money that will accomplish those five goals? And that's what you're going to see. And by the way, you'll never get everyone. There are going to be people in this room right now that says, I don't think we should do that. Or I don't care for that logo. Or I don't know about those marketing messages. I mean, there's going to happen. There's no way we can make everybody happy unless we say, come to Rochelle. We have something for everyone. And by the way, have you ever gone anywhere that had something for everyone? We don't. You know, and you cannot let local politics kill your branding efforts. You know, I love this. A product of brands for the people is a committee that compromises, kills a potential brand home run. There's more to it. This is why you never see statues of committees in public parks. You see brave leaders. And you got some brave leaders here, and that's cool. You know, if you want to do this top down, by the way, the city was a part of this, but if we did this, do you think we could even get your council to agree on a specific brand direction? No. And it wouldn't be just you. It would be, there's 19,500 cities, towns in this United States. And the best branded cities are all grassroots up. And yes, the city is a participant. But you have to remember, brands are about being known for something specific. Your elected officials are elected to be all things to all people. Brands can't be. That's what you have to understand. So if we did this as a public project, top down, this is the way it worked. There'd be enthusiasm. Oh, that Roger Brooks guy came in and with his team, and we're really pumped about this. We're really excited. That might happen. And then you do the planning, which, by the way, we're not done yet. We have more 90 days more work to do just to get you the whole plan. And so you start working on it. Then there's disillusionment when somebody says, well, that's going to cost too much money, or I don't like that idea, or why are we even bothering putting more money into downtown? I mean, probably never happened in Rochelle. Yeah, I didn't think so. And then there's fear and panic. And then there's search for the guilty, punishment of the innocents, and finally, praise and honors for the non-participants. I get that about right? Finally, number nine. You build your brand on feasibility. We listened to you. We heard what you said. And of all the ideas, we found which one of these is most feasible. It will cost the least and bring the most tax base back to Rochelle. And then finally, number 10, you build your brand through public relations, because it's what people think of you. Advertising what you use to maintain your ownership position. So when you own the coolest downtown in Illinois, then you advertise it so that everybody knows you own it. Napa Valley owns the wine brand. Are they the only wine country in the United States? Nope. Orlando owns the Kids and Family brand. Nashville owns the Country Music brand. I mean, we could keep going down the list. That's what this is about. And there's only three killers of what you're going to see today. There's never four. Number one is local politics. And it's worse with membership organizations than it is with elected officials. Local politics. Then there are lack of champions. And finally, lack of money, both public and private. The best branded places in America were built on private sector investment. Napa Valley and Wines. There's no publicly owned wineries there. Nashville and country music or music in general. That's all private. Branson, Missouri and 48 music theaters, all privately developed. I mean, heck, you could go to Lancaster, Pennsylvania. It's Amish. No public. Same thing here. Never a fourth one. And so what's been going on for a year has been a 13-step process. Sounds like AA, doesn't it? So we've been going through this 13-step process. We started about a year ago when I first came to Rochelle to meet with your team. And then over the last 6 months, we have really dug in. So I'm going to walk you through the 13 steps so you can see what has happened. The first one is we put together a brand development team and the facilitator. By the way, I'm here with, where's the rest of our team? Where's Greg? And there they are back there. See those guys back there? Those three guys. We've been here all week. And we've been doing this. We are not consultants. We're facilitators. There's no way you can have somebody come from the outside and plop a brand on you and then go away and expect you to own it. We have been doing this with you, not for you. So we're facilitators. And we have had our brand development team. This is who we've got, or our partnership. And by the way, one thing that was really an honor for us is that all these organizations pitched in money to bring us here to do this with you. And that's really great. Typically, the city or somebody just writes a check. But when you get your schools, chamber, your school districts, when you get all these organizations pitching in to make this happen, to us, we really feel a lot of pride and honor because that you went to that depth to make this happen. And that also tells us that this community cares. Now, out of these groups, these are the people that have been on our team. One thing I want you to notice about this team is that, and we have a few other people that are steering committee that have people that are from the city, but you know what? This is grassroots. For the most part, this is grassroots. Yes, the city and their staff are supporting. I would like, and one thing I want to tell you about this group. We've had numerous phone calls. They have had meetings every couple weeks. And I want to tell you, we came in Monday night. They met with us for 2 hours Tuesday morning. They came in 2 hours Tuesday afternoon and evening. They were giving up their dinner hours. Wednesday, they were here for 2 hours in the morning. They were here for 2 hours in the evening. Yesterday morning, they were here for 2 hours in the morning. They were here for 2.5 hours last night. And by the way, about half of our team came in this morning and said, I couldn't even get to sleep last night. You know, we didn't even finish doing this till midnight. I would like that brand development team to stand up and thank them so much. By the way, they did not get paid to do this. They did it as volunteers because they care and they love Rochelle. Is that somebody here being called to the principal's office? So, this has been a great team. So they've been working on this all this time. Now, the next thing we did is we asked you. This is your chance to weigh in Rochelle's future. You had 1,740 people weighed in, which remember, we've worked in all these communities for all these years. You had more people weigh in than per capita than any place we have ever worked. Wow. I mean, and by the way, for you, a lot of you did do this questionnaire. And then, by the way, we reviewed many of your areas, projects, and plans. And so, and we had more than 300 citizens attest, and we had another 100 plus here today. But I want to tell you, when we did this online survey, this report, look at this, this is single-spaced. I mean, this is, and by the way, our crew read this. And yes, there's some sarcastic compliments things in here I'd like to read you. They're hilarious. But generally, it was very thought-provoking. But this little single-spaced document here is printed on two sides. It is 329 pages long. So when you say you can't do this by public consent, it was very important for her to ask you what you thought. What you thought the challenges were. What you thought the assets were. What you thought you wanted Rochelle to be known for. And so, I mean, to compete with the school all morning, aren't I? And so, that's what we did. By the way, 55% of the people live right within the city limits of Rochelle. A lot of them live, because you know what? We want people in DeKalb to spend their money here. But a lot of these people live just right around. They're still coming into Rochelle, but they might not live in the city limits. 61% were female, which is terrific because we know who makes the final decisions of where we live and raise a family. The guys are going. And then finally, 60% were between 31 and 60, which is good. Which was good. That's a good mix. And then, another thing they said, places where, we said, where do you go with friends, family? Look, Rockford, number one, DeKalb, number two, Chicago, number three, then finally local parks, then we watch the skydivers, we go to Alfano's, we go to Flight Deck. And by the way, I don't know about you, but you know, a lot of you eat at those two places so often that they know you by name. But that's what people said. But if you look at that, other than Alfano's at Flight Deck, all the money's being spent somewhere else. And by the way, this is just kind of a, not everybody had this list. I didn't want to put all 1,740, but generally speaking, these are generalizations you're seeing. Places we hang out, other places, not here. You know, and then greatest assets, the schools, like that. You know what, I got to tell you, I've had a lot of people come and says, well, all our money goes to the schools. You know what my response was? What's wrong with that? Now, I got to tell you, this auditorium is incredible. Remember, I travel 250 days a year, and somebody said, this is pretty darn good for Rochelle. I said, this would be pretty darn good in Chicago. It's pretty cool. And by the way, schools are one of the best economic development tools a community can have. Because you know what we need to do is we want to get people to want to live here and raise their family here, and schools are going to be the number one question they ask next to quality of life. And so there you go. Schools, parks, bike paths, your location. You know what you said, challenges, lack of shopping, lack of dining, lack of attractions, activities, no real downtown, the trains and taxes. Generalization. Biggest need of vibrant downtown activities. I can, you know, out of the 1,740 people that took that question, did the questionnaire, give us something to do was about 1,740 of the people. It was the most common thing we heard in there. Give us something to do. Because you know what? We might love Walmart, but it's not that great place to go and just hang out. And Pete Alfano will want you to come and eat dinner there, but he just soon have you make room for new customers when they come in. Am I right, Pete? Where is he? Right there. And so, there you go. And then to get people to work and visit in Rochelle to actually live here, spend some time here. You said that. That's why it was one of our five goals. And then another thing, branding focus. What do you want to be known for? We heard trains. We also heard not trains. And then we heard skydiving, hub city, cycling, farming, paintball, reinvented downtown food, thrill-seeking sports. I mean, we heard tons. And we had to take all those ideas and carve them down. And then feelings. We want to be known as family-friendly, active, caring, accepting, small hometown feel, safe, clean. Now, I got to tell you, that's what all 1,250 small towns in Illinois say. So we had to be different, even though that's still important. So, we asked. And by the way, that questionnaire ran for a month. And your responses were awesome. Then we need to figure out, now who the heck are we even trying to attract? everything you're going to see is about this. Nobody cares about city limits. You have a population of about 9,500. But you know what? Within 5 miles of your downtown, you have 14,000 residents. That is your target market. Every single thing you're going to see coming up is about getting those 14,000 people to be proud to live here, to want to live here, to want to spend time here, and to give them something they can bring their friends and family to and that they will come and hang out at. That is our first thing we have to do right there. This is not about tourism. This is about the people of Rochelle. I don't care what side of the tracks you're on. We had to do something that didn't matter whether you're on the south side, the north side. It didn't matter. This is about those 14,000 people. What can we do to engage every single one of them? And then within 10-mile radius, you have almost 20,000 people. If you go out 20 miles, you got 134,000. Wouldn't it be cool if people from Rockford and DeKalb came here instead of the other way around? So that when you do go to Costco in another city or something, you know what? They're coming here. They're filling the gap of low. There's always going to be leakage. That's where having outsiders come here will help fill that gap. I mean, look at that. And then visitors coming in and staying in Rochelle. You know what? We stay at the Holiday Inn Express. And you know what? Most of the people staying at the Holiday Inn Express are working in these factories. They don't even know you have a downtown. And so, what about those people? They're here. Wouldn't it be cool if when they got done working at Nippon or wherever they're at, wouldn't it be cool if they actually, instead of going to DeKalb for dinner, said, we got to go check out downtown Rochelle. I mean, that market, they're already here. And then, look at that. You have 16 million people driving through, and that's just 88. And they may stop, and they're at the truck stop, but wouldn't it be cool? And by the way, we're not trying to overrun your town with all 16 million. But wouldn't it be cool if some of those people stopped and spent a little time in Rochelle because they heard about how cool you are? And so there it is. There is your 5 mile radius. There's Rochelle, right, the heart of downtown right there. And there it is 10 miles. And there it is out 20 miles. And by the way, there's where DeKalb is. So we're getting in the southern fringes of Rockford. And we're not quite to Dixon yet. But you can see where we're at here. But remember, our first goal, when I go back to that list, it's the 14,000 people within 5 miles. That is our goal. All the rest is gravy. And so everything we got to do is that. So now we know where they live, but who is it? We want people that work in Rochelle but don't live here. Number one priority. How do we get them to live here? And then number two, the millennials. This, the future of Rochelle rests with your people. You know what? We want people when they graduate. You know what? Last day of school is next Tuesday. Some of your seniors, they're done as of yesterday. And you know, rather than have students say, the second I graduate, I'm blowing this town. We want them to say, I'm going away to college, but I can't wait to come back home because this is a cool place. The future of Rochelle lies with people in their 20s and 30s. When they start getting married and they start having kids, that's going to repopulate your schools. And by the way, there are 84 million baby boomers. There are 82 million echo boomers or millennials. It's the next big wave. Boomers, we had our kids in our 20s. The millennials are having their kids in their 30s, even their early 40s. So there's been a gap, and that new generation is just now starting to get there. We geared everything you're going to see to attracting young people. And by the way, we learned something because we come from this industry of demographics and tourism and those things. You know what? When you cater to the millennials, us boomers are going to follow. Much to your chagrin. Really, we do. We go where you do. We want to hang out with the young people. That's different than it used to be. My parents never wanted to hang out with us when we were growing up. Matter of fact, they thought the Beatles were the worst thing ever. So, and then higher income workers. You know, one of the challenges you have in Rochelle is that you've been home to the lower demographic workers. And the higher income workers are living in other cities. We need to balance that out. Because a lot of times schools are judged on test scores. And it doesn't mean that if your school is not rated one of the best in the state, it doesn't mean that you don't have good educators or good facilities. Usually it's the demographic. We need to help balance that out a little bit more. So we're not throwing any of the lower income people away at all. This is all about them. But we also want to bring those higher income workers back. That's how we get new homes built, new subdivisions, and new investment. And then we want people looking for an activity-driven, entertaining downtown. You can tell where we're heading with this. We're going to head right downtown. And we're looking for things to do after working on weekends. Because if you work here and you don't have anything open except Walmart or Pete's Place, Alfano's, or you know, Flight Deck, you know what? Guess what? We're going to go to a different city. And then we want entrepreneurial, free-spirited risk takers. We want small businesses in this town. That's the future. We need to create small business opportunities, particularly for those millennials. That's who we're trying to attract. And then number four, we had to compile who we're trying to attract in everything you said and had to go through this process. And I always say, always do what you're afraid to do. That was Ralph Waldo Emerson. And so here's where we narrowed down the branding to. Number one, an amazing downtown. Program Plaza, public market, you name it. Number two on that list was to become a family playground. And then with lakes, the bike paths, etc. Number three was health and wellness. So this is narrowing down that list of what we heard from you. Number four was our playing up somehow our agricultural heritage. And then number five was life-enriching experiences. Life-enriching, not just experiences, but things that make your life better or more enjoyable. Skydiving center, is one of those things. But you know what? It doesn't always have to be dangerous sports. Just life enriching. By the way, I shouldn't say that. I don't think they've had any accidents out there. But that's what we did. So now, we started to narrow it down. We thought, I wonder if there's a way we could combine all of those and still be different. We think we did. Now, all brands are built on product. And this is really important. So, the plan that you're going to get, we're working on with your team, is an amazing program plaza. If you want downtown to come back, what comes first? People there on a consistent basis. You know what? If you do 10 events downtown, businesses are going to say, what am I going to do the other 355 days? See what I mean? If we can get people downtown 250 days or more a year on a consistent basis, the retailers will come back. Way back when we moved to the suburbs, the retailers weren't with us in suburban malls. And I'm going to talk about that in a few minutes. A public market pavilion, indoor, so weather is never a reason to not go downtown. And then a reimagined downtown business mix. Right now it's pretty hodgepodge. And if anything, your downtown's drying up, not getting better yet. But there's a lot of people with a lot of great ideas. Nightlife, and we're not talking about bar scene nightlife, we're talking about things to do after working on weekends. And I'm explaining that in a minute. A wayfinding system, you know what? You have some wayfinding, you're talking about directional signage, but most of it's too small, you don't see it until you're right on top of the signs. And by the way, if you're staying at, Red Roof Inn, Super 8, Holiday Inn Express, even Days Inn, all of those places, you know what? When you come out of the hotel, there's nothing that says you have a downtown anywhere. There's no signage. And so we got to finish that job. That's on the list. We need visitor information kiosks. So when people are coming here in the industrial areas or wherever they're coming into, they can get information about you. And then downtown beautification and facade improvements. Got some work to do there. And then finding solutions for the golf course and restaurant is very important. It's such a vital part of your community. And it's a stunningly beautiful course. We need to get a restaurant in there. We need to get that going again. And then, of course, improving and adding to your recreational facilities. Field houses, recreation centers. These are all part of the mix. And so additional life-enriching events, particularly geared to younger people. And that's just a few of the things. But those are the heavy hitter ones. One thing we know is that the heart and soul of every community besides its people is its downtown. You know when site selectors come into a place like Rochelle to look at where they're going to bring a business, industry, you know what they do? They go right into your downtown, and the health of your downtown economically is the health of the community in their eyes. So what do you think their impression is? We should go look at DeKalb. And by the way, I don't consider DeKalb a shining example of success, even though they've got a major university there. I think you could blow them away. And no offense to DeKalb, I think it's a great community. But I think you have that opportunity. And by the way, if you don't hang out in Rochelle, neither are we as visitors. And you're not. We're going to go where you go. You know, this is the future of downtowns. It's where we go after work. It's where we go on weekends. And so the things you need to know about downtowns is that when we can bring people back downtown, the retailers will follow. Otherwise, you know what's going to happen? You're going to build more things out there by Walmart, and your downtown is just going to keep dying. So we got to get people there. And by the way, even shoe stores are starting to come back into downtowns. Brown Shoes is a company that has them in rural downtowns everywhere because you can't find shoe stores at the mall. And by the way, guess what? Downtowns are back and in a big way. Guess what? The last time a suburban mall was built in the United States was 24 years ago. They're dying. People want downtowns. They're back. Remember Petula Clark, 1964, Downtown? How many of you remember that song? You just dated yourselves. But you know what? You remember that? They're back. People want downtowns. You know, what's really cool is there's three rules you need to know. I call it the 787 rule. And here it is. 70% of first-time sales come from curb appeal. Name a place in your downtown that has really good curb appeal. There's a couple. We all travel. Have you ever said these exact words? That looks like a nice place to eat. We all do it. Curb appeal. 70% of first-time sales. Once we go in a place, we might say we don't care what it looks like after that because we like it because of the food, whatever it is. The second one is women account for 80% of all retail spending. You go, girl. I'm waiting for the guys. Come on. Usually there's some guy in the audience that says, that's all? That's a true fact. And women want to go in places where they feel welcome, where they feel safe. And they don't feel safe in a place that has 70% of the buildings are vacant. And here's the third one. 70% of all retail spending takes place after 6 o'clock p.m. You're closed. You want to know why Walmart's open 24 hours? Because of that. This is why banks are open later than they used to be. This is why grocery stores are open until late at night. If Barnes & Noble is always open at 11 o'clock wherever they're at anymore. But the point is, look at that. Because you know what? Before 6 o'clock, we're at work, we're at school. And then we come home and you're closed. You have to fix that. By the way, this is the power curb appeal. I took that in January in Grass Valley, California, near the Sierra Nevadas. All those flowers are silk. She has an air curtain that runs down to keep the cold out and the warmth in. Does it make you want to go in? That's the power curb appeal. I mean, look at this. This is a little place up in Alberta, the coffee house. This is before. That is after. Their sales went up 400%. I mean, before, after. 400%. And you know, here's the big statement. In economic development, tourism, and community, there is absolutely, positively, I stole that from FedEx, nothing that's more important than your downtown. Nothing. Because anybody that wants to move here, start a business here, is going to go into your downtown, they're going to go, yikes, this is going the wrong way. So that is where your emphasis should be first. And so, a plaza, I want to talk about that. It's a central gathering place. People are the heart, the plaza is your soul. We are moving to the European standard. We are eating later at night. We are shopping later at night. I mean, we're graduating. I remember the old days when I was growing. My dad got off work at 5 and we were having dinner at 5:30. Now the average person in America eats dinner at 7. In Europe, it's 9. Every town in Italy, Spain, most of Europe, Switzerland, you name it, were built around piazzas, plazas. It has worked for centuries. We're a baby country. We're a couple hundred years old. No offense to the Native Americans. They've been here for a lot longer than that. But for us, we build our culture on the automobile. For the first time in American history, we want out of our cars in an intimate pedestrian setting. We want this. We want central gathering places. We're in the age of third places. The first place is the place we live. It's our home. The second place is the place we work. And the third place is the place we hang out. This is the age of third places. You know what? Starbucks built an entire brand out of creating third places. Free Wi-Fi. You could sit there all day long if you want with your computer, you know, and get on Wi-Fi. We're in the age of third places. And so I'm going to show you one. Because this is such a great example. This is Main Street Square in Rapid City, South Dakota. This is in the middle of downtown. And by the way, the next biggest city to Rapid City is Billings, Montana, which is about the size of Rockford. It's 3.5 hours away, not half an hour away. This is in the middle of their downtown. You know what I told them to do? I want you to get rid of this parking lot right here. It's about an acre. It's 60 parking spaces. And I want you to turn it into a plaza. I don't even care if you make up the parking. Now, some of you are going, oh my God, you're going to take away our parking? Because you know what? This is worth walking a block for. See what I mean? You know, yeah, we don't want parking too far away. And so, and by the way, there is a parking garage there. But even in the first floor of a parking garage, we're going to put restrooms, all those things. This is a Sears building that was actually defunct. There were pigeons living in this Sears building. I mean, that's how bad it was. So I said, I want you to turn this into a plaza. And so here it is, 3 years later. I called them the hole in the middle of donut. I went back in 2012. This is on a Sunday at 10 a.m. Look at it. It's packed. It is a central gathering place. I mean, this place is so cool that car shows started coming. Motorcycle shows started coming. Quilt guilds started coming. Pottery guilds, you name it. People wanted to host public events in downtown Rapid City. It has a great little splash pad. They wish the splash pad was 5 times bigger. Because it gets too crowded out there. By the way, they had 30% vacancies. They now have none. The place is thriving. As a matter of fact, at night, the water lights up and they have music there. This is what it looks like in the summer. And by the way, that Sears building is now full of restaurants and retail shops. It's the most valuable property in all of Rapid City. The guy that bought that building. Matter of fact, he bought the building. I told him to tear down the building. He called me up one day and said, Roger, this is Ray Hildebrand. I just want to let you know we're not tearing down the Sears building because I just bought it and I gave the city $1 million to help build the plaza. It was an investment because he now owns the most valuable real estate in the entire city. And so there it is in the summer. They wish the splash pad was this whole thing. And by the way, in the winter, it looks like that. That is 8,000 square feet. That is bigger than the ice rink at Rockefeller Center. Guess what? They make $130,000 a year just renting ice skates. And they have to dole them out because it gets too crowded. So can you imagine having a plaza in your downtown that had that water feature going 120 days of the year, 4 months, with music and stuff? Wouldn't it be cool if you had an ice rink that worked in your downtown 4 months of the year? You know what? That's 8 months of activities in your downtown. That's 240 days. That's how you bring downtowns to life. And so, you know, in the case of Rapid City, look at that picture. They do movies on the square every Monday night. The average attendance is 3,500. But here's the important thing. Somebody posted this on a social media site, and this is the point. It says down there, I grew up in Rapid City, and it was never as cool as it is now. That's what we want people to say about Rochelle. You know, the average age of a person buying a home in Rapid City, within 2 years of doing this plaza, the average age of a person buying a home dropped by 12 years because of a plaza. The youth were coming home and raising their families. So you know what I did is I went there and I talked to Dan that runs Main Street Square. I said, Dan, make me a list of the 20 businesses who fought it the most. They fought losing the parking. They fought, they said the plaza was going to drain business out of their stores. You know, they fought it. And then what I did is I went to all of these 20 businesses and I found 14 or 20 of them. I can't even remember. Maybe it was 24. A bunch of them. And I would go in and I'd say, you know, are you the owner or the general manager of the store? You know, restaurants and retail store stuff. And they'd go, yeah. Or they'd get them. And I would do this. I'd make this face. I'd go, you know that plaza over there? Does that thing really help your business? And you know what? Every single one of them said that. Every single one. Best thing Rapid City has ever done. And guess what? There are no retail vacancies in their downtown. Within 24 months, none. Lower turnover retail, less than 1% turnover a year. Wouldn't that be nice in downtown Rochelle? And then businesses now open later in the evening. And retailers are continue to break sales records. And the average population is dropping. And you know what's really cool? It is the central gathering place. You know what's really cool about Rapid City? Within 3 years, Main Street Square is almost as big an attraction as Mount Rushmore. That's saying something. It is the central gathering place. It's a year-round activity center. It includes interactive water features, ice rink. It's programmed. You can't just build a space. You know what? There are some people in this room that live in Dixon or go there. Dixon did a great thing. They made their downtown look beautiful. They didn't bring it to life. It has to be programmed. You can't just make it pretty. Because you know what? If this was Carnegie Hall, and we had beautiful chandeliers and frescoes and draperies and velvet-covered seats and everything. Would you go to Carnegie Hall if it was here in Rochelle if nothing was happening on the stage? Doesn't matter how pretty it is. It matters that there's activity going on. And so, it includes a stage, lighting, sound system. I mean, you know, incorporates year-round. And by the way, all plazas must be monetized. That means they need to be in the middle of commercial. That means we need to have them ringed with restaurants and retail shops. Building a plaza out in a park does nothing. Remember, this is about tax base. We're trying to give these downtowns a lift so that people will invest in the buildings and bring retailers back, and retailers would pay more for rent because it's worth it, because we're bringing a steady stream of customers to them 250 plus days a year. So in Rapid City, that's what it did. It took them 1, 2, 3, 4 years to get it done. So we're going to show you what it might look like. This is one we did in Caldwell, Idaho. But I just want to show you, if you could create a good stage like this, this is 20 by 50 stage, you could create this little sunken amphitheater. It might only go down a couple of feet. But during the summer, this will be all splash pad in here. And by the way, these are all flush mounts, so you can shut them off. You can fill that whole thing full of tables and chairs for a great farm-to-table banquet out there in the square. Or you could have people sitting out there for concerts or stage productions. Or during the winter, this whole thing be full of ice. For an ice rink. Trees, seating areas, look at the vendor booths, all these kinds of things, food trucks, you name it. You know, here's another example. And so we think this would be a great thing for Rochelle. It'd be the best thing you could ever do as a city. It's a great legacy for your elected officials to get involved and push this forward. So here is downtown Rochelle. Now, right here's the utility building. Right here's the fire department. So here's Lincoln Highway. And here's Main Street. So you know what we're talking about? There's the Mexican grocery store here. And here's where the gazebo is. So everybody's got, we're situated now. You know what we're talking about, right? Okay. What if this became plaza? And by the way, the home is still here. As a matter of fact, we might put retail shops. Right now it's an insurance agency. Maybe we move the insurance upstairs. We want as much retail and things fronting the plaza as possible. And what if you had ground floor retail shops here? And then what if out here we could build that pavilion market center right here? So you have indoor. And I'll show you pictures of what it might look like. So what if you did that? You know what's cool about this location? This is already owned by the city. Yes, we'd be vacating this part of Main Street. And by the way, we didn't mind vacating Main Street because it's residential on both ends, whereas Lincoln Highway is a highway. And I'll get more on that. See, I told you, there's going to be people going, oh my gosh, she's going to cut down Main Street. But, yeah, see what I mean? We want the pedestrian experience. And by the way, wouldn't it be cool if we had, look at that. That's 11,000 square feet. Remember, Rapid City's only 8. Wouldn't it be cool if you had a 10,000 square foot water feature in there? 10,000 square feet. Wouldn't it be cool if you had 11,000 square foot ice skating rink there? 4 months of the year, every November, December, January, and February. Yeah, you'd have a Zamboni, you'd have a chiller, because you don't always have freezing. But you know what? They put ice rinks in malls. Wouldn't that be cool? Wouldn't it be cool if you had a stage at the end, 20 feet by 50 feet? That's about the size of this. Well, this is a little deeper than that. So that you could do concerts, you could do stage productions, you could do chili cook-offs, you could do cooking, you could do any kinds of things in there. Bands, concerts. And then you'd have maybe public restrooms right on the square. What a novel idea. Here's my soundbite for you. Relieved visitors spend more. It's true. And by the way, upstairs, this would actually have an upstairs, and upstairs is the control room for all your sound and your lights. Because we'd want to have a 30-foot drop-down screen like this so we could do movies on square every Monday night for 14, 15 weeks of the year. Wouldn't that be cool? You know what's really cool about this plaza? It's free. It's free. It's for your citizens. It's not a pay-to-play. Anybody could go there any time of the year, and it's free. If this plaza makes no difference of your race, of your culture. It makes no difference what your income level. This is for those 14,000 people that live within 5 miles of your downtown. And wouldn't it be cool if these little white things that just popped up are like tents. You know, you could have public markets spill out there. You could put car shows there, motorcycle shows there, BMX shows. You could do a portable skate park there. You could have quilt shows, you name it. All kinds of exhibitions, events in this event staging area. And you know what? All these little yellow things you're seeing, those would be Catalina umbrellas. Those are all outdoor dining. Wouldn't it be cool if you had outdoor dining there? And by the way, it doesn't all have to be on the plaza. We want to help the rest of this downtown area too. So we have outdoor dining there. Maybe that would become a restaurant. You know, this right here would have emergency access so we could get through here during emergency. The fire department's right there. And so this does have, there'd be bollards that might pop up or down. You know, so there is that emergency access. But all these little yellow circles you see coming up are all places where you could have outdoor dining, outdoor cafes, outdoor seating. I mean, you know what? Wouldn't it be cool if you had 15 restaurants downtown? You know what? You'd have people coming here from Chicago. I was just in Tinley Park a couple weeks ago and said, we're going to be working out in Rochelle. What would it take for you to go out there? They said, well, we know where DeKalb is. Where's Rochelle? You know, and I said, well, just wait. That's what I said. You just wait. Wouldn't it be cool if you did, see, and by the way, there's already this little pathway. We want to make sure there's a good connection between the Lincoln Highway and the plaza. And then down here where you got the sidewalks, you'd have more outdoor cafes. You know, and maybe even sometime down the road, and by the way, we're not taking out this building, but maybe sometime there's a place where we could create another pass through here where you walk through the alley and there's outdoor cafes and everything like they do in Europe. Wouldn't it be cool if down the road, let's see what else popped up here. Here we go. We would create, come here, work. There it is. We could create more retail. This is a little like an empty lot right here. Maybe we even, since this street is closed, maybe sometime we could create another building right here that would be front on the plaza. This is all new tax base. This is about raising your property taxes. But more importantly, It's about increasing your retail sales. Because, you know, I think it's up 1.75% of your retail sales tax comes back to the city. Guess what? DeKalb's getting it, not you. So that's what this is about. And so then wouldn't it be cool? See all these little red triangles that popped up? These would be street vendors, street musicians. Bring downtown to life. Make it cool. Work with colleges, universities, even your high school students. And then street trees. We want street trees every 30 feet up and down the Lincoln Highway. And we want them over here on 4th. We want street trees everywhere. We want them ringing the plaza so that there's street trees everywhere. Because you know what? They create shade in the summer. They create an intimate setting in the winter. You film full of lights. They're very important. And so if you could do something like this, this would be, and then you have delivery access back here into the market. But that way we create a nice transition to your residential areas. Wouldn't this be the coolest thing ever in Rochelle? Be awesome. It would make you the showcase, not just for Illinois, but for Indiana, for Wisconsin, for Iowa, all the states around you, Michigan, you name it, Missouri, you name it. And so wouldn't it be cool, in addition to the businesses you already have, if you added those on it? Like you have an Italian restaurant in town. Wouldn't it be cool if you had a Thai restaurant, a bakery, a Brazilian steakhouse, a canteen, an Irish pub, a microbrew? Rocket Burger Bar is a guy named Billy Deck in Chicago that has one of those. You thought, man, maybe he'd open one here. It's kind of cool and it caters to millennials. You know, Brave Horse Tavern is another example. And I'm not saying these are specific restaurants. But then if you did market vendors, you might have several food vendors that are permanent in your market. Well, look at the activities. Movies on the Square, ice rink, splash pad, a climbing wall downtown. Wouldn't that be cool? You know, 40 showcase events, car shows. You know, they're going to come here when you have this. You know, there you go, street music and art, all of that stuff. You know, the best downtown in the state. That's how cool it's be. When we talk about restaurants, we're not trying to be elitist. This is casual. It's fun. It caters to millennials. It's got kind of a cool vibe. You know, lots of kind of industrial art and design. You can see all that, the heating ducts and everything. This has actually a shuffleboard in it. We want cool places like this. And when it comes to street trees, look at Greenville, South Carolina in the 70s. You know what they did? They narrowed their streets. They widened their sidewalks. They added street trees. That's it in the 70s. That's it in the 80s. We're down to two lanes where I have angle in parking. Notice the street trees? This is what it looks like now. That's what your downtown will look like. And there are people come by, well, you know, those signs, those trees are going to block my signs. Public Works, the trees, we're going to have to clean up all the leaves. I mean, there's all these arguments why they shouldn't do it. Heard some of them? You know what they're saying now? The average town that does street trees sees their retail sales and services increase by 18%. The cost of maintaining and putting in street trees far outweighs, the revenues far outweigh the costs. The revenues and increased retail sales. So when we're talking about things like this. We have these rows of street trees. And by the way, every one of these is a sitting area. You know, even in places like Disney, this is downtown Disney. Notice this raised planter area? It's all curved. It's a seating area. This is a central gathering place for the 14,000 people who live here. We want to see lots of outdoor cafes. We want to see musicians like this and magicians like this. We want to bring downtown to life. You know, little things like these. You know, in Cannon Beach, Oregon, they actually paid like this entertainer. He got paid $35, but he made a whole lot more in just tips. And he goes out there 4 hours every Friday and Saturday. You know, things like this in Asheville, North Carolina. Bringing in food trucks until we can get our restaurants really going down there. Even vendor carts. These are all revenue streams. And by the way, every vendor cart is an incubator. We're hoping they start with a vendor cart or food truck and move into an inline business. Wouldn't that be cool to have this kind of activity? Wouldn't it be cool to have artisans in action? The guy standing there is doing little stained glass things. And by the way, people are 4 times more likely to buy art when they meet the artist. So wouldn't it be cool to do this? They have portable glass blowing studios now. These kind of things taking place downtown. Wouldn't it be cool if that water feature looked like that at night? Wouldn't it be cool if you did a water feature that every night for half an hour or 20 minutes we'd do a show like this? During the day we wouldn't have major fountains like this because it'd be a little tough on the kids. That's what you call Enema City. But the point is, you might at night do a little show like that for 20 minutes where people come and they gather. And guess what? That's incentive for business to stay open late. You know, wouldn't it be cool over on the Lincoln Highway if you created something like this? See what I mean? And by the way, you know that public market? We thought, why don't we call it the Crossroads Market? You are the hub city. See that? Wouldn't that be cool on the square? And by the way, all those garage doors have windows in them, and during the summer you could roll them all up. And it creates an open, wide open pavilion. In the winter you might close them down. That's a cool building. And by the way, on the inside, you could host a ton of different events. This has a center stage with a grand piano on it. So sometimes it might be farmer's market, public market. It might be a Christmas tree for us. I mean, heck, it might host all these kinds of events, home shows, garden shows. You know what? You'd have people from Rockford, from Chicago, from Aurora, from everybody coming here instead of you going there. You know, wouldn't that be cool if you could do these kinds of things here? And by having that market downtown, you know what? Weather is never an objection because it's indoors. If weather's nice, we roll up the doors. If weather's bad, we keep them down. Or you open up every one of them. And so we think doing something like this here would be really cool. You know, we'd also like to see you, do you have the skydiving center? But we'd like to see you host things that are going to cater particularly to millennials, like Tough Mudder. We'd like to see you host these kinds of events like that. Or like the Warrior Dash. These things, by the way, the Warrior Dash moves, does all over the world. And by the way, they do them in heats of 500 people. So all we need is 20 acres somewhere. And by the way, we're not going to do this on the square. They need mud. But somebody, there's probably 20 acres where they could host these kinds of events. You're going to have people coming from everywhere. I mean, wouldn't it be cool if you did these kinds? This is the Festival of Colors. You know, and then by the way, I just want to let you know, we did look at parking. Everything in yellow are parking lots. Yes, some of these are private, but maybe, you know, maybe we can use church parking lots because we're using them on weekends during the week and during the evenings. You know, we don't know. You know, maybe we can develop more parking lots. And you know what? When you go back to that list of these things that you thought we do, what I just showed you incorporates every single one. Wouldn't it be cool on a morning like this, it's beautiful outside, if you had yoga on the square? Wouldn't that be cool? There's no reason why you can't do this. And you know what's cool? It's free. Nobody is excluded. Wouldn't it be cool if you had food festivals, the Taste of Rochelle there, farm-to-table events right in your downtown? So that's a little taste. So let me go through the other rest of these. Now, we know who we're going to attract. We know where they live. We've got a good idea to make downtown the most amazing downtown in the Midwest. And by the way, of all the things you can do, this, that, what you just saw, cost the least will have the greatest return on investment. Remember, you have $1 billion spent here in industrial. You have $60 million worth of schools, new schools that are phenomenal. This is a fraction of those to do this. And it's going to be the hub. That's what we're calling it, the hub. So you know those gateway signs that say we're the hub city? You know where the hub is? It's downtown Rochelle. That's what's cool. Let's go to the hub. You know? So, a brand is a promise and an expectation. So we can't tell the world. We can tell the world this is coming. And we want you to tell your leaders here that you want this. We need you to go to the city council. We need you to go to your economic development organizations, your chamber of commerce. We need the people to say, do this for us. We're crying, dying for things to do that make us proud of Rochelle. And so, how do you make it different? How do you make it memorable? How do you get it to evoke emotion? How do people go, oh my gosh, yeah. We need to do some of those color renderings like I showed you. So this is it. There's your brand promise. Providing an enriching social experience in an amazing downtown. That's what this is about. And by the way, to prove it, It's going to be an intimate gathering place alive with music, food, and incredible year-round public market. By the way, that public market is going to be open at least 4 days a week, 50 weeks of the year. This is not just a pop-up and takedown. And it's open into the evening hours. Everything that you do there is mainly going to be between 4 o'clock in the afternoon and 9 o'clock at night. It's the place we go after working on weekends. Look at that. Multicultural entertainment, more than 250 days a year for every single resident of Greater Rochelle. And so, this is my space, my place, Rochelle. Wouldn't it be cool if people took ownership of Rochelle rather than being embarrassed about it? There's your brand promise right there. This is my space, my place. We want people to take ownership. And when we talk about my space, my place, we want your kids to think that. We want the people that are hanging out at your restaurants to do that. We want your market vendors to do that. That's what this is about. And so, our brand pillars, what makes it my space, my place, is healthy living, active, farm to table, clean air that you have here. You know, the other thing is life-enriching culture. Then the next thing is nightlife. And we're not talking the bar scene, we're talking about activities, things for families to do. And so, how do you make it a bold statement? How do you claim it, own it? Brands are about ownership. And then how do we evoke emotions? Sometimes we might raise some eyebrows. How do we make it memorable? How do you elevate yourself above everybody else? And so then we came to the look and feel of the brand. And Greg Frisell, our creative director back there, this is what he does. And we call him number 7. He's so disappointed that he's not number 1, 2, 3, 4, or 5, or 6. But this is where the look and feel. You know what most cities do? They start with a logo and a slogan as number 1. It's number 7. So you want to see what it looks like? By the way, what you're going to see are some concepts. We did not have photography of Rochelle to work from that we wanted. You're going to see some photography and you're going to go, well, that wasn't taken in Rochelle. We know. We will replace these with photos from Rochelle. What you're going to see is nothing's final. Over the next 90 days, we're going to finalize it. We just want to show you the feeling we hope to portray. So that's why I want you to take it that way. Because what's going to happen is you will have a style guide created. And there will be professional photography, videography. But we just want to show you kind of what it looks like, what it might feel like. You know, it might look like that. You know, whoops, let me go back. It went by too fast. We wanted to use, come here, go back. Is this thing going to fight me? There we go. Don't you love technology? When it works. And so, things like that. We love some of these quotes. One cannot think well, love well, sleep well, if one has not dined well. Healthy living, downtown. By the way, there's just fake text there, but I'm going to read you one here in a minute. But that might be one. Once again, wouldn't it be cool if this is what your market looked like downtown? You know, wouldn't it be cool if you had ads that might look like this? There is a certain happiness in being silly and ridiculous. This is life enriching. Wouldn't it be cool if the body text went something like this? By the way, team, I did this in big, huge letters so I wouldn't have to fumble for my reading glasses. Yeah, that's what happened to us yesterday. But what if that text said something like this? Just an hour and a half from Chicago is a place you'll want to hang out, and once you arrive, you'll be looking for a place to live. Remember what our goals were? Chock full of free thinkers, risk takers, and entrepreneurial spirits, Rochelle, Illinois is also chock full of surprises. Anchored by one of the most amazing plazas and public markets in the Midwest, the Hub and Crossroads Market is alive with music, food, art, and magic nearly every day of the year. With a 10,000 square foot splash pad, an incredible ice rink all winter, and 40 weekends of cultural fun and engaging entertainment, is it any wonder that downtown Rochelle has become the poster child for comeback cities everywhere? So come out and play in the Midwest's best gathering spot. That is what's going to keep people want to live here, to start a business here, to invest in downtown, to bring their businesses back. You might do ads that look like this. Culture resides in the hearts of the minds of its people. Cool Cinco de Mayo events. Remember what I said, this is for everybody that lives here. We've seen a lot of Japanese people here that are working at Nippon or coming here. We've seen the Hispanic population, Afro-American, you name it. You are very culturally rich. Nearly 17 languages are spoken in this town. All of them are included in this. Doesn't matter what side of the tracks you're on. Wouldn't that be cool? You know, and by the way, we didn't over-formalize it. We wanted it to be kind of funky, kind of cool, a little bit industrial. You know, wouldn't it be cool if you did ads that might look like this? Life happens at the end of your comfort zone. You know, and by the way, we will replace that with an actual one over Rochelle. They actually have some really great photography over there. You know, or there might be ads like this. Life is about moments. Don't wait for them. Create them. This is a life-enriching place. And by the way, these can be used for economic development. Because for the first time in U.S. history, quality of life is leading economic development. Before that, it was always natural resources and transportation. Your economy is built on transportation, the hub city. For the first time, it's changing. So you know what's next? Now we've got to develop the action plan. That's what's going to happen over the next 90 days. Branding, what is it you want to be known for? The most amazing downtown in all of the Midwest. Development, what do we have to do to own it? You just saw it. And then marketing, how do we tell the world? And you're going to see a to-do list. And by the way, strategic plans, we believe in action plans, a to-do list. And by the way, strategy, goals, objectives take no more than 3 pages. This is going to be a step-by-step plan how to do it. And it is a to-do list. It's going to say, here's the recommendation. Here's who's charged with it. By the way, we need Kiwanis, we need Rotary, we need the city, we need the hospital, we need the school districts. We need economic development, we need tourism, we need everybody's going to play a role in this. This is not one organization doing this. And what's it going to cost to implement? Where's the money going to come from? We have to answer these questions, and when would it be implemented? And then what's the rationale for doing it? And by the way, this is Alpena, Michigan. But you know what? Your plan doesn't need to be any more than 30 to 50 pages. There's recommendation number 27, number 28, there's 44, there's 45. I just threw up a few pages there. You know what? This is a plan that sits on your desk, not on a shelf. How many of those do you have? That's what this is about. Because at the end of the day, when it becomes a team effort, you'll go from this. I call this the Economic Development Express. They're really clipping along, aren't they? Is that about right? When we get this plan done in the next 90 days, and by the way, 2015, as you're getting ready, you're going to go from this to that. When you get everybody on the same page, pulling in the same direction, guess what? You're going to win. There's no reason why you can't do this in 3 years. Get it built. And I know some of you are saying, why can't we get it done this year? You know, the public process does not move that fast. You know, and by the way, we also have to have private sector. By the way, one thing I said, the city's not going to build this plaza until the private sector commits to doing their part. This is the age of public-private partnerships. You can't build a plaza down there and have the back of those buildings looking the way they do now. They all need a front on that plaza. And if you've been back there, you know some of them have stairs up here and down here. I mean, a lot of work has to be done. We have to put the power underground. That means if you put the power underground, you can't have those telephone poles there. That means all those old historic buildings, we had to take the power that's coming in the roof and have it come down underneath. Yes, it's going to take a public-private partnership. We can't build a space down there and have nobody else do anything in downtown. Otherwise, you're going to have dead space. Our whole goal is to increase retail sales in your tax base. And you know what? When you increase your retail tax base, all of a sudden you're going to have funding to do cool projects like recreation centers, like field houses, like getting your golf course organized and taken care of. That's what this is about. And then number 9, you got to make something happen. And so it might be as simple as putting up pole banners like this in your town. You know, and by the way, remember this. You're saying, I don't remember that in downtown Rochelle. We just superimposed those on there. But they might be pole banners that look like this, kind of cool, kind of, you know, they don't look, they're actually brighter than that. The projector's so far away, it doesn't make it real bright. You might have wayfinding signs that looks like that. Bigger, bolder. Make it cool. And then number 10, keep the energy high. Don't fold to the naysayers. You know, look at this. Forget all the reasons why something may not work. You only need to find one good reason why it will. And we can give you tons of reasons why it will. We've seen it. We've done it. And then don't fold to the cavers. You know what cavers are? You ready? Citizens against virtually everything. You probably got a few. We've never been in a place that didn't. And the people that are negative are they're going to be the most vocal. They need to hear from you that are positive. And then a diamond is merely a lump of coal that did well under pressure. That's who we're looking for to champion this cause. Number 11. You got to tell the world once this thing is going. You are going to do the very best of Rochelle. We want to promote your top restaurants, your top retail shops, your top activities, golf, your sports facilities, the lakes, Lake Sewell, those places. We got to promote those. And by the way, notice that cool little thing? Hashtag spirited life. This is just not life of ordinary. This is spirited. And so you know what? Key marketing messages happening at the hub. You know, holidays at the hub, habaneros at the hub. I mean, hang out at the hub. You know, wouldn't it be cool? Life is about moments. Don't wait for them. Create them. Challenge sports. You know, that is those things like the Tough Mudder, 5K runs, 10K runs, Dan Skin triathlons, all those kinds of things. No boundaries. You know, free thinkers, risk takers, and entrepreneurial spirits wanted in Rochelle. That's what you're about. Illinois' best gathering place. I mean, these are all, there it is, spirited life. These are all better together. We're better together. You can't say that in Chicago. You know, and then think outside, no box required. That came from one of your 18-year-olds. So these are key marketing messages. And by the way, between now and when you can use these, we call these bridge branding, Rochelle Reimagined. That's what this is. Or you could even do Rochelle Rising. Or you could even do Hub Strong, which you've been using since the tornado. There's no reason why that can continue with the redevelopment of your downtown. Wouldn't it be cool if you had posters like this? Spirited Life. But showing your downtown. Wouldn't it be cool if you did posters like this? Fun. It's engaging. Wouldn't it be cool if you had city vehicles that look like that? Or like that. Is that cool or what? We want you to make a statement to own it. You know, we already took the liberty of redesigning the city's letterheads and stuff to look like that. We even have our... Oops, let me go back. Sometimes this thing does that. We even did cool things like we got a little, you know, signature stamp with the R for Rochelle. You know, wouldn't it be cool to have business opportunities in Rochelle? A community profile. The top 10 things we need downtown or anywhere in Rochelle. Wouldn't it be cool if your water towers all of a sudden look like that? Make a statement. Own it. Wouldn't it be cool if you had logo gear like this and like this? And by the way, we're in line to first to buy some. Wouldn't it be cool if you even had farm-to-table trays like this with Rochelle actually burned into the wood? Or even hats like this. Or, you know, even put, you know, water bottles like this or coffee mugs like this. Make a statement. Own it. And then number 12, revisit that plan every couple of months. Like I said, it sits on your desk, not on a shelf. And then finally, our last one is we need a brand leadership team. And so I'm almost done. Never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed people can change the world. It indeed is the only thing that ever has. We're looking for those people. Number one, they have to be 100. If somebody says, you know, I kind of like this. I think it's okay. You're not on it. If you go, yeah, damn straight, get me on that team, we want you. Okay? They must be doers, not directors. We need doers, not people that attend a meeting once a month and then go away. They need to be willing to take some hits, because I can tell you right now, there's going to be things in the paper everywhere, and some people are going to be doubters. Some people say that last thing we need is throw more money into downtown. I can hear it now. They need to take some hits, because this takes brave leaders. And you know what? They will be brand cops. There's a look. There's a feel. And by the way, none of that's finalized. Those are just our initial drafts. Matter of fact, our team hadn't even seen a lot of the stuff you just saw. And then more than half should have a vested interest in the brand. That means we want people in downtown to actually help champion this. Property owners, businesses. Why? They're going to champion it even in the face of controversy, because their paycheck depends on it. And they are the voice of the brand. We need these people to go to Kiwanis, to go to Rotary, to go to the city council, to go to the hospital board, school boards, to go to economic development boards, to go to everywhere and talk about this. And then number 7, they can't be politically divisive. They can absolutely be elected officials if they champion this. And we hope we do get those. And they will act as the steering committee for band-related projects. There's a lot of work that has to be done. And then they will push the agenda forward, and they will never take no for an answer. They're leaders. Leaders. And at least half should be under 40. Look around you. Where are they? They're
at work.
They're at work. You're right. And you know what? That's funny, because that's what I said when we started. I said, you know, that they're at work, school, you name it. But the point is, they're the future. We'd love to see you start a young professionals group right here. We've had a couple of your young people on our committee. And boy, I'll tell you, where's Michael? Where is he? Oh, there he is. Michael back there works for the chamber, and we have just nailed him every day, because he's a perfect millennial. He's married, his wife is pregnant, they're going to have a child in the next couple of weeks. And we say, so what would make you proud to live here? Why would you? And he lives here already, and he's already proud of it, so don't get me wrong. But we've been asking him, Maddie. Is Maddie here by chance? No, she's probably, okay, she's not here. It's Peggy's daughter. And we've been asking the young people, because they are the future. So there you go. And by the way, nothing great was ever achieved without enthusiasm. That's my life motto. And then finally, life should not be a journey to the grave with the intention of arriving safely in a pretty and well-preserved body, but rather to skid in broadside in a cloud of smoke, thoroughly used up, totally worn out, and loudly proclaiming, wow, what a ride! And last time I showed you this, a few months ago, I had older people up there. I've switched it to our under 40 crowd. If this is you, you let us know. When we're done here in just a couple of minutes, you'll see these people wearing badges. If you want to be part of this, let them know. We need you. We need as many champions as we can get. By the way, in Alpena, Michigan, there's our champions. And you know what? It always came down to a couple people, Jeff right here and Missy. And they were ones really carrying the torch, even though we had lots of champions. By the way, I could have put a circle around him, because he's married to her and will do whatever she says. Guys, we know how this works. Here's Moosehead Lake, Maine. This is what we're looking for. And by the way, right afterwards, we're going to get a picture of you and your champions here. You know, I mean, this is Oskaloosa, Iowa. You know, we've got our young people here. I mean, you know, I mean, here's Caldwell, Idaho. We need champions. And so, here's to the very bright future of an amazing up-and-coming town, Rochelle. Thank you so much for coming out this morning. Thank you very much. Thank you.